Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Inox Wind Limited Q2 FY22 results conference call hosted by Systematix Institutional Equities. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Amar Kedia from Systematix Institutional Equities. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thanks, Faizan, and good evening, everyone. On behalf of Systematix Institutional Equities team, I welcome you all for the Q2 FY22 post-results conference call of Inox Wind Limited. We have with us today the team from Inox Wind being represented by Mr. Devansh Jain, Executive Director, Mr. Narayan Lodha, Chief Financial Officer, Mr. Jitendra Mohnani, Group Financial Controller. I will now hand over the call to Mr. Jitendra Mohnani from Inox Wind for his opening remarks, and we will then open the floor for the Q&A. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Amar. Good evening, everyone. I welcome all the participants of this earnings call. The board of directors of Inox Wind Limited has approved the financial results for the quarter ended 30th September 2021 in the meeting which was held today. I trust you would have had an opportunity to go through the results. To take you through the key highlights or key operational highlights, post-COVID second wave, which impacted our execution in Q1 due to non-availability of oxygen, the execution was back on the track during the quarter, albeit the seasonality factor, which was a monsoon season, peak monsoon season. The execution is getting further accelerated during the current quarter. On the front of 3.3 GW, we have to inform you that the major components for the same have arrived and the remaining are expected soon. The turbine should be launched in quarter three FY22, and thereafter the commercial ramp-up from quarter four FY22 onwards shall pick up. Execution of Continuum Project Nani-Wirani 52 SPV and various retail orders is progressing well, and commissioning of the turbines is taking place progressively. Our consolidated order book stands at 1,276 MW. I'll take you through also key financial numbers and financial performance. Our EBITDA has continued to be positive. Now, for the quarter and half year, the revenue and EBITDA compared to the corresponding quarter, revenue of 229 crores in Q2 compared to revenue of 171 crores in Q2 FY21. Now, this 229 crores in Q2 FY22, the revenue of 229 crores includes 63 crores towards the supply to step-down subsidiary Nani-Wirani, which has got eliminated in process of consolidation. The EBITDA of rupees 4.9 crores in Q2 FY22 against the EBITDA loss of rupees 33 crores in Q2 FY21. There is a significant positive swing in EBITDA. The revenue and EBITDA compared to the corresponding half year. Revenue of 398 crores in H1 FY22 against the revenue of 268 crores in H1 FY21. Again, there is 390 crores of revenue includes 63 crores of towards supply to step-down subsidiary, which has got eliminated in the process of consolidation. For the half year, EBITDA of rupees 7.6 crores in H1 FY22 against the EBITDA loss of 59.8 crores in H1 FY20. Now, I'll request Mr. Devansh Jain to provide an outlook on the sector strategic initiatives which are being taken and the significant market opportunity. Over to Mr. Devansh Jain.
Thank you, JM. Good evening, everybody. I'm gonna talk about the strategic initiative and how we see the market opportunities playing up. We've kind of revamped our presentation, which we've been taking out quarter on quarter. We've made it far more sharper, focused on a lot of actions which are taking place at our end. And then if you could refer to slide 6 of our strategic initiatives, we've broken this into four parts. One is the balance sheet actions we are working on, two, the product launch, three, the mix of product and EPC as we see going forward, and fourth, the monetization of our O&M piece. As we've mentioned, we are committed to significantly reducing the interest costs of the balance sheet, which is not just by retiring high-cost debt, but also ensuring infusion of capital by leveraging the IWISL equity, amongst others, to move the company towards a very light balance sheet, keeping in mind the debt. As you all would have noticed, in the recently conducted board meeting, the board has approved. Of course, it's pending ratification by the shareholders, for which we have an EGM on the 29th of this month, post which the promoters have committed to infuse up to 100 crores in Inox Wind Limited. This is keeping in mind the maximum permissible limit of up to 5%, which can be directly purchased by the promoters at any point in time. Over the last quarter, IWEL, the holding company of Inox Wind Limited, also diluted its stake by about 5% to raise about 100 crores, which has been infused into Inox Wind to further deleverage the balance sheet and also provide long-term working capital requirements, keeping the upcoming ramp-up in operations from this quarter. We've also taken requisite approvals for issuing preference shares of about 1,300 crores and some other securities. This would lead to significant reduction of interest costs on the Inox Wind balance sheet, as well as strengthen the balance sheet further. With respect to the product launch, we had mentioned that we are working on the 3.3 megawatt turbine, and in the ensuing wind season, we would be launching this turbine. We're happy to say that we've made a fair amount of progress there. We've got majority of the key components now in India. We're awaiting the final two or three components to arrive. As soon as that arrives, we should have the prototype turbines up, and post which, we should gradually move towards serial production starting from Q4 onwards. Just to remind you, we have still a very large 2 megawatt order book, so we still need to supply that in. And along with that, we would start supplying our 3.3 megawatt turbines. And it's actually a mix of customers. So there's a lot of trust from retail, C&I captive guys who are using the smaller turbines, and a lot of the larger turbines are the ones which would be going to the PSUs as well as the IPPs. The third key area of strategic initiative for us has been that to mitigate EPC-related risks, we are already using majority of the sites where our common infrastructure already exists. And going forward, we are focusing on more and more equipment supply and very minimal EPC-related tasks, so that we focus more on things which are well within the factory boundary as opposed to beyond the factory boundary. This would enable certainty of margins and reduce risks in terms of margins which the EPC business carries. The fourth strategic initiative is the monetization of our O&M business, and we have taken certain significant steps over the quarter gone by, and in the recently conducted board meeting, we have taken approval to hive off the EPC business, which was carved under 100% subsidiary of Inox Wind called IWISL, into another subsidiary of Inox Wind, such that IWISL, subsidiary of Inox Wind, becomes a pure play O&M company. As many of you would be aware, the O&M business enjoys extremely high beta margins in the range of 40 to 50% upwards. And we believe there is tremendous scope for organic and inorganic growth. And we believe this could be a separate business vertical altogether, which could significantly drive revenues and growth for the consolidated wind business going forward. The third piece, or the third relevant part, is significant market opportunities. Given the fact that India is already facing, or many parts of the world are facing, this massive shortage of power, and thanks to COVID, there has been an increasing focus on renewable energy, I think this makes it all the more relevant. From an India perspective, of course, there has been massive announcements of our renewable energy goals being ranked up from 175 gigs by 22 to 450 gigs by 2030. More importantly, over the past couple of months, we have seen massive announcements. And I, to some extent, I think the sector seems to have been re-rated in the eyes of investors as well as in the eyes of banks and so on and so forth, where you've seen the likes of Reliance, NTPC, Adani, GSW, amongst others, announce extremely ambitious renewable energy plans for the next few years. In fact, the plans cumulatively announced by some of these guys is in excess of 200 gigawatts. And mind you, India's installed capacity at this point in time is close to about 120 to 130 gigs. We're increasingly seeing a lot of traction in hybrid tenders. In fact, in the recently conducted hybrid tenders, as well as the pure wind tenders, there has been significant outbidding, overbidding. So we've seen almost 5x of the capacity bid volumes being 5x of the capacity which was available for tendering. A whole host of new IPPs, new pension fund-backed money, PSUs, besides the existing large IPP players, are increasingly bidding more and more in larger quantities, which will bode well for the sector in the months and quarters to come. So I think that's a little bit about the sector and some of the key aspects which we are focusing on as a company. With that, I think we'll leave the floor open to questions and answers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one at this time. The first question is from the line of Utkar Somaya, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. So given that you recently sought shareholders' approval to vote for the special resolution, specifically item number 2, wherein you intend to take a 1,000 crore loan, which is virtually interest-free, I have a few pointers which I'd like some clarity on. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah. So in the past, you have indicated that your firm intends to merge IWEL with IWL within this financial year. Please provide clarity on that. Point number 2, for the same, you initiated moving the company's registered office to Gujarat, and recently you canceled that. And point number 3 is, by doing this, you're virtually stripping away all the assets of the holding company IWL, as the loan given to IWL is interest-free. Please clarify the intention of the management, and more importantly, please communicate and give us clarity as to, will the merger take place between IWL and IWL, and will it take place this year? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. First and foremost, there has never been any official communication with respect to IWEL and IWL merging. It's one of the options in front of the board, and the board will take appropriate decisions. The boards of both the companies will take appropriate decisions at the right point in time. There is no statement that within this financial year, both the two entities will merge. So let's put facts straight up. Second, with respect to the registered office, due to various commercial considerations, we are not going ahead with that. And I think we provided abundant clarity on that in terms of the release, which was taken out by the company. Coming to the third point, in terms of stripping of assets of the holdco, I hope you do realize that the holdco owns 50.5% of Inox Wind. And at the end of the day, the holdco's valuation is majorly dependent on what the valuation of Inox Wind would be, number one. And number two, while we're converting a lot of the debt given by the holdco into preference shares do provide interest at some point in time and dividends. So it's not as if the holdco is left without any assets whatsoever.
So why is it interest free?
Well, it's a preference share. So when you issue preference shares, you get dividends, right?
Yes, so it's 0.01, which is virtually
While we respect your questions, at the end of the day, it's for the boards of both the two companies to decide what is in the long-term interest of both the organizations.
But this is not in the interest of the shareholders of IWEL, because they are removing money from one company without any return given to the shareholders. So,
I'm sure your thoughts are welcome, and you know you may vote accordingly in the ensuing EGM.
I'm just trying to understand your thought process as to why you are given an interest-free loan.
I think I've made myself extremely clear, and I think the board is taking appropriate decisions. We respect every individual's and every investor's views, and they're free to vote as they deem fit.
And again, on your initial decision on shifting the office to Gujarat, can you please tell us as to what is the thought process behind that?
Strategically, we have took some decision, and rest of the company, that's why we had not shifting, and due to COVID other things, we had decided to continue the rest office to our existing Himachal Pradesh. So I don't think it will affect anything on the boards and company. In the interest of the company, this decision has been taken.
Thank you, Mr. Utkarsh Somaya. May we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhishek Velu, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Congratulations, sir, on the great set of number. My question is regarding the monetization that you are trying to do. And my question is regarding IWISL. Sir, I have a couple of questions regarding IWISL. So first question is, what kind of debt will the entity have on itself after the transaction is complete? And sir, any guidance on the kind of top line and profitability that it will have in the future? And third question is regarding the timeline of the transaction. So what when we can expect this transaction to complete? Sir, these are my questions.
Thank you for your questions. I think with respect to point number one, what we intend to do with respect to the pure play O&M entity, we intend to keep debt of up to 200 crores prior to the capital raise. Post the capital raise, we expect to make that net debt free. That's the intent. Your second question was with respect to guidance. So at this point in time, we have a 2.2 gigawatt fleet under turnkey O&M contracts and about 800 odd under shared services. We, as the Inox Wind fleet grows and we have a fairly large order book, naturally this fleet will keep growing. Besides the fact that there are various OEM assets available, the OEMs of which are under distress or in financial difficulties, and customers are looking for a strong O&M player. Besides the fact that there are various small aggregators available in the market, we believe once we are able to raise a significant amount of capital and make this a pure play O&M entity, we would be ideally positioned to aggregate a lot of this capacity under the plain vanilla O&M company, IWISL. So we won't give out any specific guidances, but we expect significant growth year on year. We'll talk more about transaction specifics as we move forward. In terms of timelines, we've broken it up into two or three slots. Of course, we started last year with converting some of the creditors into equity of IWISL, and as a result of which, from a 100% subsidiary, it's become a 98.4% subsidiary. And I think month on month, you should be hearing news and announcements on that front.
Okay, sir, that was very helpful. Sir, I have one more question. Sir, do you intend to list this entity separately?
I'm sorry, I would not be able to answer that question given SEBI guidelines and forward-looking statements. But, on a generic basis, we would do whatever it takes to generate value out of our O&M vertical.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. That was it from my side.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhijit Bora from Sharekhan. Please go ahead.
Sir, firstly, I would like more clarity on this promoter infusing like almost 1100 crore. So, your press release which you have released recently mentioned that it will be other than cash for the 1000 crore. What does that mean?
JM, can you take that question, please?
Yeah, Abhijit, good evening. Yes, because preference shares will be issued for a consideration other than cash. For the reason is that the holding company Inox Wind Energy Limited has, Inox Wind Limited has borrowed from Inox Wind Energy Limited, which is reflecting as intercorporate debt, ICD. So those ICDs will be converted into preference shares and interest thereon. So that is the transaction which we are going to have.
Okay, so that 1000 crore will go away from like the debt. And what is the external debt which we are having apart from this intercorporate loan?
We've got about 900 crore of external debt, I think. Net debt would be 900, Narayan?
On
approximately.
Both companies.
On, yeah. Console on level. The console level, we would have about 900 crores of external borrowings.
Okay, apart from this like 1000 crore which will be like converting from for the intercorporate loan, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And secondly, like I would like to understand your strategy in terms of like how you would go ahead with the turnaround of your business, in both in terms of the margin and the execution part.
I'm not sure how to answer that question, but in terms of how we go about turning around the business, well, it's a function of the whole sector turning around. You know, when the sector shut down in the transition from the feed-in tariff regime to the auction regime, it was basically like how a cinema business shut down under COVID. What will you turn around when under COVID the whole business shut down? Now that the whole sector is moving up and you're seeing tremendous auctions, policy clarity, PPA clarity, evacuation clarity, transmission lines under the green corridor already established, the sector is already turned around. It's now about ramping up volumes, number one, post-COVID, and number two, taking out the right products with the right profit margins, and that's exactly what we're doing.
Okay, so any guidance in terms of the like execution, like for like 22-23, what kind of execution in terms of the megawatt you would like to target to like get the benefit and the product mix, if you can just guide something on that part.
Unfortunately, we don't give out forward-looking guidances, but I think we've always maintained we should be about 15-20% of the market next year. I think that's a good enough estimate to put out there, number one. Number two, with respect to product mix, as we get the 3.3 up and running over the next quarter after the prototypes, I think in the ensuing financial year, the next financial year, we should probably have a 50-50 mix of our 2 megawatt turbine and our 3 megawatt turbine.
From like next fiscal or like from FY22?
FY23.
Sorry?
FY23.
Okay, and if I'm not wrong, at like if the market size is 4 gigawatt, if when you say 15% opportunity for you, you can do on an average 600 megawatt annually, right?
It's easy match, yeah. So if the market is 4 gigs, I think that's where we should be. If it's 10 gigs, it will be a different number, and if it's 1 gigawatt, it will be a different number.
Okay, and finally, can I get the order executed in Q2 and H1, and also the WG wind turbine sales volume?
GM, do you have that? Narayan, do you have that? Those details?
We'll whatever your questions are, just email us. We'll send you the separately. Right now, okay. We don't have the data. Just please email us at investors.
Okay, okay. And sorry, one last clarification that you mentioned that IWISL will be having 200 crore of debt and you post the halving off, right? And you target to make it debt free or net debt free?
Well, our focus will always be in terms of net debt free. You know, you'll always keep liquidity at some point in time, keeping we have significantly high growth ambitions. So, frankly, whether it's debt-free or net debt-free really doesn't make much of a difference.
Thank you, Mr. Bora. May we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions? Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants in the conference, please limit your questions to one per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, we would request you to rejoin the question queue. The next question is from the line of Mandar Sherbet from S-Logic Investment Solutions. Please go ahead.
Hello. My first question was about EPC business that you are hiving off, and the strategy that you will be more looking at equipment supply than the entire contract of equipment plus EPC. So will this strategy affect the O&M business, because whoever does the EPC work might get the O&M contract as well? Can I post the next question as well?
I mean, either you can go ahead with all your questions or we can answer your questions and then you can keep moving. So maybe you put out your questions and then we'll answer your questions.
Okay, at least one more right now.
Go ahead.
About IWEL's recent AGM, there was a resolution about permission to drop the stake in IWEL below 50%. So how much do we intend to sell from IWEL's total stake that we have? 50.5 we have right now, but will it drop significantly?
Okay, Manda, thank you for your questions. Point number one, with respect to the EPC business being hyped off into a different vertical and us reducing our focus on EPC, I let's put it like this. Why does majority of the O&M remain with OEMs? It's primarily because, unless someone creates a 2 or 3 gigawatt fleet of a single turbine type, managing the supply chain and the spare part inventory is a mess. Now, these margins are true for OEMs to the extent that they're managing large fleets. When someone's going to keep 200, 300 or 400 megawatts of a single turbine type, if he starts keeping inventory of blades, gearboxes, generators, control systems, drives, the cost of carrying that inventory will be obnoxious. And two, how many gearboxes, how many generators, how many blades, how many drives should he carry? So frankly, the right way to look at it is we've seen this over the past 5 or 6 years now. While we control 2.2 gigawatts on a turnkey basis and 800 on shared services, all these guys are struggling and none of them want to control it, because for these guys who are, say, investing 3, 4, 5, 8,000 crores, maybe larger every year, making 5, 10 crores on gross profit doesn't make any sense, because their capex investments are much more. Their focus on managing the entire supply chain, the O&M piece, is much more. I don't mean to say that 100% of O&M contracts will always be with OEMs, but majorly all OEM contracts, O&M contracts, will be with OEMs, unless and until, of course, the OEM itself is in a financial soup or is on the path of closure.
Yeah, I got the point. Yeah, thank you. About the next question, IWEM.
With respect to the IWEL stake below 50.5, look, I can say this fairly confidently. This is only an enabling resolution. From what I understand, I don't think there is any intention to take the stake below 50.1%. So effectively, this is just an enabling resolution, but I don't think there is any intention to raise any further capital by selling stake of Inox Wind Limited, which is owned by IWEL. Okay. As you may have noticed, the promoters themselves are infusing another 100 crores.
Yes.
Because that's capped at, say, 5%, number one. And number two, with the proposed fundraising plans which we have for our O&M vertical, I think the wind business is extremely comfortably placed going forward.
Yes. This EGM details are really heartening to know. As a shareholder, I'm very happy to read about all these details. Just one last question.
I'm glad you appreciate the larger term vision of the boards of IWL and IWEL, since some people seem to be looking at shorter term views.
Yeah, right. Just one last question about IWISL. Could you share the equity number right now, issued equity right now?
Ladies and gentlemen, the line for the management has got disconnected. Request you all to please stay connected while we connect the management. Thank you.
आपण ज्या व्यक्ती सोबत बोलत आहात त्या व्यक्तीने आपला कॉल होल्डवर ठेवला आहे. कृपया लाईनवर राहा. द पर्सन यू आर स्पीकिंग विथ हॅज पुट युअर कॉल ऑन होल्ड.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for patiently waiting. The line for the management is reconnected. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
उधर जाओ कितना खास है यार कोविड वोड मत देने जा रहे हैं. Hello.
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
So we were on call with I think Mr. Mandar Sharbat, and
yes.
We got disconnected.
Yes, sir. The line.
Yeah, I'm here. My one last small question about IWISL. What is the equity base right now? Means we are infusing some 600 crores in equity in IWISL, right? So before that issue, what is the equity size? Can I have
Narayan,
that number?
You have the data. Can you answer that?
So present equity size is 120 crore rupees, but definitely we are infusing more and more equity in IWISL also. So exact number, if you send us the email, we'll send you the exact number.
Okay, I just was looking at the number of shares, issued shares right now. Anyway, I'll email you separately. Yeah, thank you. My questions are answered.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Deepak Podar from Sapphire Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir, for the opportunity. So, I was just going through the presentation now. The order book of about 1280 megawatt, which translate into 7,500 crore revenue, that execution you have mentioned over next 24 months. Is that right?
That's right.
Yeah. So can you give us some indication in terms of how do you see the execution over next 2 years? Since over next 2 years you have given, so FY22 and FY23, how do you see execution bifurcation?
Well, not really FY22, it says over the next 24 months. So frankly, we're talking of, let's say, from a 1st October perspective, over the next 24 months, you would expect to do this kind of volumes, which, I mean, if you kind of just split it into half an hour, that would throw up about 600 megawatts in a year. So it's, you know, I think there's enough data publicly available on the presentation. And I think as COVID moves away, as things are getting back to absolutely normalcy, of course there are some supply chain constraints globally and shipping constraints globally, but I think we are well geared, and with some of the capital infusion and capital raise which we are working towards, I think our aims and ambitions would be to get back to our historical top line, which used to exist till 2017 prior to the sector shutting down.
And by when is that we are targeting?
I mean, that's something which we'll keep seeing quarter on quarter. I mean, I don't think as the market is opening up, as the sectoral challenges are over, as, you know, it's a function of how the market keeps playing out. We're seeing tremendous momentum in the market at this point in time.
Right.
And all the regulatory issues are behind us. So frankly, I mean, you know, we should be seeing a ramp up quarter on quarter.
Ramp up quarter and quarter. Fair. So you did talk about 600 megawatt annual execution, right? So that comes to maybe about 150 megawatt on a quarterly basis with some maybe plus minus. So is that something that we want to achieve on a steady state basis post the ramp up? That
yeah, I did mention that's something which is there over the next 24 months. And yes, if you ask intent, I think that would be the intent. Of course, we have to keep in mind that there have been challenges over the past 1.5 years in terms of COVID shutdown. You know, as and now that we have the regulatory issues behind us and we have transmission issues behind us, COVID has really derailed a lot of stuff. Thank God COVID is behind us and everyone's safe. But I would go on to say, yes, that would be the intent. And I think a quarter here on there, we should gradually be moving towards those goals.
Thank you. This is the operator, Mr. Podar. May we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Paras Nagda from Enam Holdings. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, Devansh. Thanks for the opportunity. Devansh, my question relates to this gross receivables, and I'm looking at the annual report whereby it states that the 3 to 5 year window of the receivables were due for last 3 to 5 years is close to 400 crores out of the 1350 crores as of March, and where we only provide 15%. Devansh, could you give us some comfort on this dues, because I understand these are from the days of the regime change which happened, and there was certain dues which are happened. So could we get some kind of clarity on this these receivables? And secondly, can we have a slightly more aggressive write-off policy? Was my suggestion.
So Paras, I think first and foremost, as you must have noticed over the past 12 to 18 months, we've kept a very aggressive write-off policy. We've provided for almost close to 300 and 250. Almost provided for close to 500 odd crores of receivables and 350 crores of receivables, which have been written off from the P&L and have been cleaned up. In terms of this 3 to 5 years specifically, we have about 200 odd crores, which are in certain PSUs, which we are extremely confident of winning and recovering those dues. In fact, just recently we've succeeded in getting our BGs back from one of the PSUs against whom we had to file certain legal cases. I think, you know, the challenge with PSUs is they're extremely slow. And legal cases with them go on for some time. There's no enmity, if I may say so, but, you know, we still need to recover our BGs and our cash. The other 200 odd crores were some of the old assets which we were reselling and kind of clearing. This is something to a great extent which would be completed within this financial year. And yes, we did mention whatever is left over, say we still have about 100 odd crore of sticky receivables, if at all, we will provide for it within this financial year so that the entire balance sheet is as light or as clean as it can be. And I'm sure you would appreciate that we have been extremely aggressive in terms of providing and writing off past receivables over the past 18 months.
Surely. Thanks, Devang. Really appreciate your understanding in this. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Gautam Bahl from Morion Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks for taking my question. First of all, congrats on the improving operational performance and strategic initiatives. It's quite exciting as a shareholder. I just had one sort of thorny issue, really. On the Holdco merger issue, I understand that it's a board decision where to merge the two companies. However, it's abundantly clear that the best case scenario for IWEL is a merger, right? Especially post this preference shares issue. So it would be good to get a directional feel of what the promoter mindset is on this issue, especially because it's coming up for a vote in the EGM. Given promoters are the largest shareholders, surely it's in your interest to get this holdco discount taken away, right? So why not just commit to the merger? Why would you not do this is my question.
So Gautam, thank you for your thoughts and your comments. Okay, let me make it clear. First and foremost, the promoters are majority owners of Inox Wind Limited as well as Inox Wind Energy Limited. So naturally, a merger would be in the interest of the promoters as well, not just the minority shareholders. Having said that, there have been various opportunities which have cropped up, and some of those opportunities require a lot of agility and quick decision making, such as the one which we are evaluating and implementing for our O&M vertical. The boards of both the companies have never publicly said that they will be merged. Again, they've also not publicly said that they will not be merged. What we're doing at this point in time is simply converting the advances and the ICDs to preference capital. Eventually, I would tend to think that they would be merged, but again, that's my personal opinion. I think going forward, once we're kind of done with the transaction on the O&M side, the boards would evaluate that. And you know, to the best of my knowledge, or what I think would be right, would be to eventually merge these two entities. But that's my personal belief. Officially, I cannot say anything more.
No, I totally take that on board. I mean, obviously, it's a directional
See, logically, again, you mentioned it yourself. What's in the interest of the minority shareholders is also in the interest of the promoters. So, frankly, there is no conflict of interest to eventually consider a merger of the two entities.
So it's effectively that, you know, you have a lot of strategic initiatives going on right now. You want to finish that first, And
exactly.
You'll do the no-brainer decision, which is too much. I mean, I'm not asking for a commitment, but there's no reason not to do that, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely, Gautam. And I'm sure the boards of both the two entities would be thinking on the same lines as well.
Okay. Thank you, Devansh. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhijit Bora from Sharekhan. Please go ahead.
Only one more question, that like, what is the cost of debt and how we target to reduce it? Post these balance sheet improvement measures, like how it will pan out going forward?
I think maybe you can connect with our team. They'll take you through the exact details. But broadly, the cost of debt is about 11% at this point in time. More than that, I think how we're going to reduce it is naturally with the infusion which is taking place, number one, with the 100 which was infused by IWEL, the 100 with the promoters are putting in, the 1100 or 1300 which is being converted into preference shares will eliminate interest. And fourthly, the proposed fundraise which we are targeting for our O&M vertical is what would put together considerably eliminate the debt in the consolidated wind business. For more specifics, you know, I would request if you could get on a call with our finance team and our investor communication team, they would be more than happy to take you through the specifics.
Okay, and any timeline for the fundraise for O&M business?
Look, we did mention our aim is to do, you know, you would be hearing more from us on that month on month, but our broad aim would be to kind of do this over the next 6 to 8 months.
Okay, thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nitin Gandhi from KIFS Trade Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, can you share some thoughts on sustainable margins, considering that you are facing a lot of supply, logistic issues and other things? So do you think there is any threat on the margin which are, and where do you think more or less like in gigawatt terms or operation terms, break-even point? Thank you.
Look, so in terms of sustainable margins for the plain vanilla supply model, we should be at 12 to 16% EBIT margins. That would be sustainable. The O&M business obviously is a 40 to 50% plus margin business. And I think in terms of break-even point, I think given what we're intending to do on the preference shares, on the fundraise and the O&M monetization, larger goal would be to virtually make this a debt-free entity over the next 6 to 9 months. And if we succeed at doing that, our break-even would possibly be sub 50 megawatts.
Thank you. Wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. So one moment, please. As there are no further questions from the participants, I now hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for being a part of the investor call for Inox Wind. As I would say, we are extremely excited about the various opportunities in front of us. We are significantly enthused by the re-rating of the sector and the massive announcements by PSUs as well as some of India's largest corporates in terms of volume commitments, which are in excess of what India has put up in the past 30 years. Our company is ideally placed to cater to that, and towards that, we are taking significant actions on the balance sheet, on the product launch, as well as monetization of certain assets which we own. And I think we would be reporting back on many of these things month on month as we move forward. But things are looking extremely bright. COVID is behind us. We are ramping up our manufacturing as well as our execution on the ground. We are in discussion for significant orders across the board, not just for our 3.3 megawatt platform, but also for our 2 megawatt platform. We have a significantly sized order book at this point in time. And I think we are ideally positioned in the Indian market to
significantly take a large chunk of the PSU share, the retail captive CNI share, as well as a significant part of the IPP piece. Thank you for your interest in our organization, and we look forward to connecting with you over the next couple of weeks and months as we update you about significant actions at our end, besides, of course, the Q3 developments. Thank you, be safe, and wishing you all a happy Diwali in advance. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Systematix Institutional Equities, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.